This video is going to be about my current conception of the universe and the Big Bang model according to a classical general relativity picture. Now, earlier my opinion was that the universe should be closed curved. And there are reasons that I thought this. They are conceptual problems that you have with an open universe that you don't have with a closed curved universe. For example, the closed curved universe model, you can conceptualize extrapolating back all the way to a zero scale for the universe by taking a cross section of it and imagining it according to the rubber balloon model. You can imagine the rubber balloon expanding with the expansion of the universe and extrapolate back to a zero scale factor when the balloon becomes a zero radius, at which point all points in the space become the same place. You can't, however, conceptualize that with an open universe. You can mathematically write it down, but you can't conceptualize extrapolating an open universe all the way back to a zero scale factor when all of the points in the space become the same place. It also boggles the mind that as you extrapolate back to the moment of zero scale with an open universe, initially at the zero scale time, you have all of the points in the space being at the same place, and then the immediate moment after the time zero, where you had the zero scale, immediately thereafter, you have points in the space having finite displacement from each other. So in that infinitesimal time, you had finite expansion, which means that the extrapolating back to the moment of the expansion of the universe itself, you had infinite speeds of the points expanding apart from each other. And that's a conceptual problem. It's not a mathematical problem, but it's a conceptual problem with the model. Now here's a problem that becomes both a conceptual and a mathematical problem. In a closed universe, you have a finite amount of matter. So in a closed universe, yes, as you extrapolate back to a zero scale, you have a diverging energy density of the matter. However, when you're extrapolating back to that zero scale, it doesn't become any worse kind of a divergent energy density than contracting mass down to a delta function in conceptualizing a point particle, for example. Now, on the other hand, with the open universe, you have an infinite amount of matter in the space. And when you extrapolate that space back down to a zero scale, you have an infinite amount of matter being crunched down into an infinitesimal displacement. And so you have a worse kind of a divergence of the energy density, a worse kind of a singularity for an open universe. Now, I think that the way that you get out of these problems for the open universe is that really we're imagining this with a classical model. And when you get down to small enough scales, quantum mechanics matters. And so the classical model that we're using should not be expected to remain descriptive of the Big Bang that we have prior to times where the scales of quantum mechanics matter, at which point you really need to have a quantum gravity theory in order to have descriptions of what the universe would look like at times prior to quantum scales. And so, for example, the classical Big Bang model should not be expected to be descriptive of anything prior to Planck time from after the Big Bang. And you don't have conceptual problems with the Big Bang all the way down to that scale where quantum mechanics starts to become involved. So until we have evidence supporting a particular quantum gravity theory, nobody is really justified in saying that they know what happened in the universe in time scales prior to which quantum mechanics really matters. We can have theories that are quantum gravity theories that make predictions about what that state should have been prior to these time scales, and so we can talk about what we think happened prior to such time scale. But until we have evidence sufficient to really justify asserting the predictions of a quantum gravity model, we really can't say that we know what happens prior to times when quantum effects really matter. So why is it that I now conceptualize a universe as open flat as opposed to closed, even though it has these conceptual problems? The reason that I model it this way now is because the evidence is more in support of a flat universe than any other model. We get that from our mapping of fluctuations in the cosmic microwave background radiation. The angular size of those fluctuations agree with flat universe models of an expanding universe with minor fluctuations in the microwave background. If you computer model such expansions of the universe, your fluctuations in the cosmic microwave background radiation in your computer model, if it is for a flat space, will have an angular size that will agree with the angular size of the fluctuations in the cosmic microwave background radiation that we have observed. And so it is because of the evidence best supporting the flat space model that I'm going to model the universe as flat. So I'm going to give you an example of how you do this. And in the model that I'm going to do, I'm going to say it's a universe of uniform matter distribution, and the Ricci scalar of the matter is going to describe a universe with a positive cosmological constant and otherwise only electromagnetic radiation in the universe. So the reason that I do this is because there is some evidence that the universe expansion has an acceleration term which is in accord with a positive cosmological constant. So to do this model, we start out here, since we're doing it for a uniform matter distribution, we start out with the Robertson-Walker metric. Basically, four physicists in the 20s and 30s independently worked out the solution for an expanding universe with a uniform matter distribution, Friedman, Lemaître, Robertson, and Walker. However, they did it independently. So there's a bunch of different line elements that you see out there according to whichever coordinates they independently chose to use. And you'll hear it referred to as different subsets of the names depending on which line elements are being referenced from who and who's being used as resource material in the references that you read. So the more common, I think, that you will hear it referred to is the Robertson-Walker model. And since the evidence is that the universe is flat, we're going to use K is equal to zero. Now, if the cosmological constant were zero, you would have a expanding universe for which that function A squared is proportional to the time that is the time coordinate used in this line element. There are other choices of time coordinate that can be used in the Big Bang model, but if it's this line element using this standard of coordinates, then a flat universe with a zero cosmological constant would have a squared being proportional to time. Now, how do we determine the behavior of a squared for a positive cosmological constant and otherwise just electromagnetic radiation in the universe? Well, how we do that is we need to calculate the Einstein tensor and the Ricci scalar and work out what we need that to be in order to satisfy the stress energy tensor of electromagnetic radiation, uniform in all directions, and have a positive cosmological constant. And it turns out that the math is easier to do this if I define a function f that is equal to a squared. So that's what I'm going to do. Replace that a squared with f and calculate the Einstein tensor. And this is the Einstein tensor and its corresponding Ricci scalar below. Now, once I've done that, we're modeling the universe as having a positive cosmological constant and only electromagnetic radiation pressure otherwise. So the Ricci scalar has to be minus 4 times the cosmological constant. So we have a simple second order differential equation to solve, which undergrads should be able to do. And for example, for a negative cosmological constant, you'd have simple harmonic motion. For a zero cosmological constant, you'd have a linear function of f as a function of time. And for a positive cosmological constant, you would have a hyperbolic sine or hyperbolic cosine function of the time with a runaway expansion. So we have this expression for f for the flat universe with a positive cosmological constant. So now what I want to do is set my time coordinate so that the Big Bang happens at time equals zero. That's when f should be equal to zero, is when time is equal to zero. And so I'm essentially choosing then that constant by that condition B being equal to zero. Now, I also choose my constant A so that the current value for the line element becomes in agreement with that of special relativity. So basically, I have just scaled my coordinates with that constant A so that the line element is appropriate for our natural choice of coordinates right now. And in doing so, this capital T in the line element here that we now have is the current age of the universe according to this standard of coordinate for time that we are using, which again is not universal, but we're using, it's pretty standard, and so we're using this coordinate of time. That capital T is the age of the universe according to this coordinate of time. So now we have our line element model that turns out to be for a positive cosmological constant and otherwise just electromagnetic radiation of uniform distribution in the universe. And here is the corresponding Einstein tensor for that line element. Now that Einstein tensor, you see, is each term in it is just a sum of two terms, and one of them's lambda, the cosmological constant. So it's easy to separate out the tensor for the cosmological constant part. This is sometimes also referred to as the dark energy in the universe, from the rest of it, which is the stress energy tensor of the electromagnetic radiation that's left over in the universe. Now, it turns out that this model that I've done, when I set the Ricci scalar equal to minus 4 lambda, what that corresponds to is choosing the universe so that the electromagnetic radiation in it always stays electromagnetic radiation. It doesn't become massive particles. So this is just an example model. If you wanted a universe to have phase transitions that produced massive particles, you'd have to go back to that Ricci scalar equation and put in something different as a function of the cosmological time for it and solve that differential equation. So the difference between this model and our real universe is that in our real universe, the early history of the universe had the electromagnetic radiation undergoing a phase transition where it produced a whole lot of ordinary matter, protons, neutrons, electrons, and dark matter. In fact, a lot more dark matter than ordinary matter. And as a result, the energy density of the cosmic microwave background radiation that we actually observe is actually about 10 to the minus 5. The energy density that I have in this model for the space-time right now, that's indicative of how much of it got phase transitioned into ordinary matter. One other final note that I'll make concerning the conceptual model of the universe and what this implies that I think is significant is that since we have evidence that the universe is flat, that it is open because it is flat, that means that there is an infinite number of stars in the universe. There is no end to the universe. And because there are an infinite number of stars in the universe, an infinite number of planets in the universe, an infinite amount of oxygen and water in the universe, an infinite amount of organic compounds in the universe, that no matter how big or small or minuscule that you believe, the odds are that intelligent life will come to be in a planetary system naturally in the universe, no matter how minuscule you think that odd is. Since there are an infinite number of these things in the universe, because it is flat, because it is therefore open, that means that there are also an infinite number of worlds in this universe with intelligent life. The evidence for the flat universe that we have is evidence that not only are we not alone in this universe, but there are an infinite number of intelligent civilizations out there. And what's more, the only question about it is what the density of occurrence of intelligent life is in the universe. Now, I think that density is actually pretty low. Not the density of the occurrence of life, but the density of the occurrence of intelligence. And real quick, I'll explain here is why. If we look at the history of our own planet, pretty much immediately after we had saltwater oceans in our geological history, we have fossilized proteinoids, basically single-cell life that we can actually replicate in the lab easily, readily. Just basically take aminos, which can also be produced naturally, dumped into salt water, you heat it up, like if it's near a volcanic vent, you dump it into cold salt water, like it's flowing out into the ocean, and you get proteinoids forming, which are the early single cells without the nuclear content that eventually evolves. And in the history of our own planet, it takes about 1 billion years, and then you have evolved the interior chemical structure to the point of nuclear walls. And so basically you have both at that point prokaryotes and eukaryotes. A billion years after you have life on the world, as long as you maintain the salt water oceans. And the problem is, after that, it takes another couple of billion years before you even have a Precambrian explosion of complex multicellular life. And so it takes a few billion years before you have interesting aquatic life. And then it's really only in geological times, the more recent history of our world, that we have really interesting land animals, be it mammals or dinosaurs or whatever you might have, insect life. This kind of diversity is really recent in geological terms. And then how long it took to get to where we had technologically intelligent life occurring on this own Earth. What that tells you is, if you come across a world that has life on it of any kind, and it's, you know, some random time throughout that world's life history, it is more likely that you will find that world with just cellular life in its oceans than that you will find it with interesting multicellular life crawling around on its shores. And it's much more likely to find it in that state. And then it's because of how long it takes to have intelligent life, and such a small sliver of our own Earth's history has had intelligent life, it means that it's going to be extremely rare that you come across a world that's going to have intelligent life. Now, like I said, though, the universe, the evidence is that it is flat, which is that it is open, which is that it has an infinite number of stars, which means that intelligent life like our own occurs naturally an infinite number of times. So we're not alone, but it's not like that we're going to be battling it out with intelligence life over who gets what habitable world, because there are so many more habitable worlds out there than there are worlds with intelligent civilizations. Quid erat demonstratum.